Welcome to the session where we're going to deal with hematology, a little about the pathology and the medicine part. But before that, we are going to deal with a little of the physiological aspect. So coming to the topic proper, the first one is a very important one, that is the sites of erythropoiesis. The sites of erythropoiesis. Now, talking about the fetal life and then after birth. First, we're going to deal with the major site as well as the minor site later on. Okay, now, in the fetal life, up to 6 weeks, the major site is yolk sac. 6 weeks to 6 months, it becomes the liver. And from 6 months onwards, till the birth, it is bone marrow. And then the minor site, up to 6 weeks, it is liver. 6 weeks to 6 months, it is spleen or the lymph node. And from 6 months until the birth, it is liver. So this is major, very important one, the major site. So once again, up to 6 weeks, it is yolk sac. 6 weeks to 6 months, it is liver. 6 months to birth, it is bone marrow. Now coming to the afterbirth. From the birth till 5 years, it is bone marrow of the long bones. And beyond 20 years, it is the bone marrow of membranous bones, including the vertebra, sternum, ribs, and so on. So this is very important one, the major site. The fetal life as well as after birth. This was asked in many of the MCQs, whether it be AIP, GP, or the different state PG exams, as well as a few UPSC rules. So next one, with relation to the erythropoiesis, the viruses that cause suppression of erythropoiesis, important. They are parvo-B19, which is the most commonest one. Okay, next one. Hepatitis, it is non-A, non-B, and non-C. Then we have Epstein-Barr virus. Then we have cytomegalovirus and HIV. Among all this, what you need to remember is parvo-B19 virus is the important or the most commonest one. Okay, so suppose a question comes, which among the following is causes suppression of erythropoiesis? The options are parvo-B19, hepatitis, Epstein-Barr virus, and all of the above. Your answer should be all of the above. But if your question is the most common virus causing suppression of erythropoiesis, and these are the options which are given, your answer should be parvo-B19. Okay. Now, one more information. That is, hemoglobin content of fetal blood rises to the level of 12 gram percentage at mid-pregnancy. Okay. At mid-pregnancy, the hemoglobin content of the fetal blood will rise up to 12 gram percentage, and at term it is about 18 gram per deciliter. Okay, so this is a little information regarding the sites of erythropoiesis. Now, coming to the next one, that is the stages of RBC's development. Now we have 1 to 7 days. The first day we have a stage called as pro-erythroblast. Okay, this is a particular stage where the first identified cell. This is the first identified cell in the RBC series, and this is a place where the synthesis of HB starts. So synthesis of HB starts in the day one, where the stage is a pro-erythroblast. Next one, the day two, we have basophilic erythroblast, otherwise termed to be an early normoblast. This is a stage where the nuclei disappears. Then we have stage or day three, in which we have a polychromatophilic erythroblast, otherwise termed to be an intermediate normoblast. And in this stage, the hemoglobin starts to appear. Then we have day four, termed to be normoblast. And there's the last nucleated stage. We have day 5 to 7, reticulocyte. There's an anucleated stage, and it escapes into the circulation by diapedesis. Okay, now day 7, we have a mature RBC. And it attains a biconcavity. So these are the stages, namely pro-erythroblast, basophilic erythroblast, polychromatophilic erythroblast, normoblast, reticulocyte, and lastly, a mature RBC. Okay, so your question may come, the commonest ones are synthesis of HB starts in pro-erythroblast. HB starts to appear in polychromatophilic erythroblast, otherwise the intermediate normoblast. In which stage the cell escapes into the circulation by diapedesis? Your answer should be reticulocyte. Okay, so this was about the stages of RBC development. Coming to the lifespan, we have normal RBCs, we have fetal or neonatal RBCs, then platelets, we have transfused platelets, and we have the polymorphonuclear neutrophils. Okay, so lifespan of normal RBC is 120, fetal or neonatal RBC is 90 days, platelets it is 7 to 12 days, transfused platelets it can go from 36 hours, even a range of 1 to 7 days, and then the polymorphonuclear neutrophils, that is 8 to 12 hours when in circulation and 4 to 5 days in tissues. So similarly, we have half-life. Normal RBC, it's 60 days. Platelets, 2 to 3 days. Transfused platelets, it is 1 day. And polymorphonuclear neutrophils, that is 6 to 8 hours in blood. Okay, lifespan is again an important topic to remember. Now coming to the important cells in peripheral blood smear. Now, the question may come that this a clinical condition can be given and they can give you a lot many cell types to choose which is the most commonest one in these particular conditions or vice versa. So, this is a gist which I have made. So, in this, we have a cell type and the clinical conditions which is given. The first one is the spherocytes. So, spherocytes are seen in hypersplenism as well as autoimmune hemolytic anemia. Okay, so next one is target cells. Otherwise, in the target cells, we have leptocytes, chondrocytes, Mexican hat cells. Okay, so this can be seen in the hemoglobinopathies like sickle cell anemia. Then we have thalassemia. Then we have liver disease. So these are So the target cells will be seen in these conditions. Next one, we have schistocytes, and that is the fragmented RBCs. So this is seen in megaloblastic anemia, microangiopathic autoimmune hemolytic anemia. Then we have severe burn conditions, then thalassemia, as well as the iron deficiency anemia. Okay, so next one is the Burr cells or helmet cells or echinocytes. This is basically seen in the uremia and hemolytic uremic syndrome. Important ones, anything can be asked. So you can write it down or you can take a screenshot of this. It's a very important one. So Burr cells or helmet cells or echinocytes is seen in uremia and hemolytic uremic syndrome. Next, coming to the spore cells or acanthocytes. These are seen in abnormal lipid metabolism, post-splenectomy, this is splenectomy, then hemolytic anemia, cirrhosis, malabsorption, and neonatal hepatitis. Okay, so teardrop RBCs is the next one. In which this is seen in myelofibrosis. Okay, this is seen in myelofibrosis. Next one is the heme bodies, which is seen in the glucose 6-phosphate dehydrogenase deficiency. Then ring sideroblast is seen in sideroblastic anemia, myelodysplastic syndrome. And punctate basophilia is seen in lead poisoning. Very important one is lead poisoning among these. And then the aplastic anemia and myelodysplasia. So these are the few cell types and these are the conditions where these can be found. So spherocytes, target cells, we have leptocytes, chondrocytes, Mexican hat cells, fragmented RBCs, Burr cells, then helmet cells, echinocytes, or the next one is Burr cells or the acanthocytes, teardrop RBCs, Heme's bodies, then ring sideroblasts and punctate basophilia. So I have noted down the important ones which were asked previously in this. Okay, like there are a few other, like we have Howell-Jolly bodies, which are seen after splenectomy or even in case of megaloblastic anemia, severe hemolytic anemia and all that. Okay. So these were the important ones. Next one, we'll go into the morphological classification of anemia. So we all know about this. Just a revision. So morphological classification of anemia, this is based on the mean corpuscular volume of the RBC. Now, if at all, the mean corpuscular volume is less than 80, then it can be a microcytic anemia. Under that, the causes can be sideroblastic anemia, iron deficiency anemia, thalassemia, anemia of chronic disease, and leg toxicity. If at all the MCV is between 80 to 100, it can be a normocytic anemia and then also a reticulocyte count. Then we have to go for a reticulocyte count. In that, if the reticulocyte count is normal to increase, we have the causes like aplastic anemia, chronic renal failure, anemia of chronic disease, parvo B virus, that is 19 infection, and malignancy, basically leukemia. If at all the leukocyte is increased, okay, so either it can be a blood loss or it can be hemolytic anemia. Under the hemolytic anemia, we have extrinsic cause and we have intrinsic cause. Under extrinsic cause, it can be autoimmune hemolytic anemia. Otherwise, it can be a non-immune hemolytic anemia. Under the non-immune, we have microangiopathy, we have toxic, that is venom, and we have the burns. And then one more, the intrinsic cause, we have membrane defect, we have hemoglobinopathies, as well as the enzyme deficiencies. But if the MCV is more than 100, we have the macrocytic anemia. It can be a megaloblastic, it can be a non-megaloblastic. Megaloblastic, they are because of the vitamin B12 deficiency, we have a folate deficiency, and a drug induced, that is a folate antagonist. Then we have a non-megaloblastic. The causes are being alcoholism, chronic liver disease, hypothyroidism, blind loop syndrome, aplastic anemia, and MDS. Okay. So this is about the morphological classification of anemia. It is based on the mean corpuscular volume. So we have three. What's the microcytic anemia? We have normocytic anemia and the macrocytic anemia. Okay, so next, let's go to the next one. Starting with the microcytic hypochromic anemia. Microcytic hypochromic anemia. And in this, the first is the most important one. That is the iron deficiency anemia. So remember that iron deficiency anemia is the most common cause of anemia worldwide and in India. And this is most commonest nutritional deficiency disorder. Okay, now with respect to this, I would like to say that the iron is absorbed almost exclusively in ferrous form. Remember, it is absorbed exclusively in ferrous form, mainly from the duodenum as well as the proximal jejunum. Okay, now in adult, iron is distributed as mainly hemoglobin. Okay, mainly hemoglobin, that is 65%. Then other one is transferrin, that is 0.5%. Then heme and non-heme enzymes, that is 0.5%. I repeat, in adult, the iron is distributed as mainly, first should be hemoglobin, that is 65%. Then transferrin, that is 0.5%. Heme and non-heme enzymes, again, that is 0.5%. Now let's see that in iron deficiency anemia, what can we see in the peripheral blood smear? It is what we can see is a hypochromic and a microcytic with a decreased MCV picture. But in bone marrow, what we see is a decreased myeloid erythroid ratio, and we can see a micronormoblast. Okay, so one more thing which you need to know is in iron deficiency anemia, the first stage is negative iron balance. Okay, that is because of the depletion of the iron stores manifest as a decrease in serum transferrin levels. So first stage is negative iron balance. So when the iron stores become depleted, the serum iron begins to fall. Okay. So gradually the total iron binding capacity increases as the RBC protoporphyrin levels. Once again, I'll tell you, in iron deficiency anemia, the first stage is negative iron balance. Now, after this, when the iron stores becomes depleted, the serum ions begins to fall. And gradually, the total iron binding capacity increases. Okay, so this is what you need to remember a little about it. And because of that, you can see the lab diagnosis also here I have given. increase in the total ion binding capacity, then decrease serum iron, decrease serum ferritin, and increase in red cell protoporphyrin. Okay, now with respect to this, we have the signs and symptoms also. Now, signs and symptoms, there's easy fatigability, then we have pallor, then keloids and colonochia. Okay, now coming to iron therapy. So the we give oral iron therapy. Okay, now it is given in reticulocytosis, which appears or begins to appear in 3 to 4 days, with a peak in about 10 days of the starting the treatment. Now let's see how does it work. In the day one, there can be a subjective improvement. Day two, erythrocyte hyperplasia. Day three, reticulocytosis. Day 4 to 30, increase in HP, and 1 to 3 months, restoration of the stores. Now, this is what exactly happens in the iron therapy. Okay, basically in a oral iron therapy. So, this is a little information regarding the iron deficiency anemia, very important one. So, in iron deficiency anemia, which two factors will be more? That is the total iron binding capacity and the red cell protoporphyrin. And what are the things which are going to be decreased? That is the serum iron as well as the serum ferritin. Next one, let's come to the thalassemia. Okay, now we know that thalassemia is basically divided into alpha thalassemia and beta thalassemia. Okay, so let's go to the pathophysiology of beta thalassemia. This is a little important one. Okay, pathophysiology and the features of beta thalassemia. Now, we know that basically the thalassemia is quantitative defect in the hemoglobin synthesis, right? So, diminished synthesis of beta globin chain with a normal alpha chain. That is what happens. Now, here see, a beta globin guide in which a chromosome 11, there is a missense or nonsense mutation that is taking place. And because of that, there will be a decreased beta globin synthesis with relative excess of alpha globin. Now, this will lead to a beta thalassemia. Now, in this, because of beta thalassemia, in that there will be abnormal erythroblasts and the RBCs. Abnormal erythroblasts and RBCs. Now, in this, we have two. One in which there is an ineffective erythropoiesis in the bone marrow. And the other one, it can be a microcytic hyperchromic RBC. Okay. So, let's see the ineffective erythropoiesis in the bone marrow. What happens in this? We have two things. One can be an extramedullary erythropoiesis. The other one can be anemia as such. In the extramedullary erythropoiesis, we have hepatosplenomegaly that is going to take place. And even there can be a bone fracture and, bone pain and fractures. Okay. Now, in case of anemia, if there is anemia, definitely there is going to be a tissue hypoxia. That is going to lead, or that is going to lead to synthesis of erythropoietin, and then from there we have a bone marrow expansion, and then we have a cortical thinning, and as a result of cortical thinning, we have bone pain and fractures again. Okay, so once again, ineffective erythropoiesis in the bone marrow, we have extramedullary erythropoiesis and anemia as such. In extramedullary erythropoiesis, we have hepatomegaly and bone pain and fractures. Due to anemia, we have tissue hypoxia leading to, secretion of the erythropoietin, and which there is a bone marrow high expansion and leading to cortical thinning. Again, cortical thinning again leads to the bone pain and the fractures. Okay, now when there is anemia, there is a need of blood transfusion, right? Now, when there's a blood transfusion, if it is more, there can be a systemic iron overload and deposition the visceral organs. Now, we'll deal with one more, the microcytic hyperchromic RBCs, in which there is a extravascular hemolysis. Correct. Now, when there's extravascular hemolysis, the same thing happens, a systemic iron overload and deposition in the visceral organs. The organs are like here, pituitary gland, thyroid gland, parathyroid gland, pancreas, testes or ovary, liver and heart. Okay, now in these, that is from pituitary to testes, if there is a systemic iron overload and deposition in these organs, there is going to be an endocrine dysfunction. In the liver, there is going to be cirrhosis and hepatitis. And in the heart, we have arrhythmia as well as heart failure. One thing. And one more which you need to know here is the extravascular hemolysis can also lead to bilirubin stones. Bilirubin stones. Okay. Now, one thing which I've forgotten over here, in the bone expansion or bone marrow expansion, the appearance of the person will be a crew-cut appearance, a frontal bossing will be there, as well as a chipmunk face. Okay, so this was regarding the pathophysiology and the features of beta thalassemia. Okay, now, one more thing which you need to know is the Nesterov's test. Okay, Nesterov's test is the naked eye, single tube, red cell, osmotic fragility test. Once again, naked eye, single tube, red cell, osmotic fragility test. Okay, now this is a simple and a rapid screening test for the detection of beta thalassemia. Now in this, what will happen? What we can see is a decreased osmotic fragility. Okay. Now, on the other hand, in case of hereditary spherocytosis, the osmotic fragility will be much increased. Now, also, we can see the target cells. Target cells we have already dealt with, leptocytes, the choroid, the Mexican hat cells. All these we can see in the peripheral smear. Okay, in case of a beta thalassemia. Okay, this is something which you needed to know regarding the thalassemia. The next one, the topic is sideroblastic anemia. Now, talking about the sideroblastic anemia, this is caused due to a defect in the incorporation of the iron into the heme. Okay, into the heme. Now, etiological factor, basically, is a genetic disorder, or even we can say it's a myelodysplastic syndrome. Now, this will evolve into hematological malignancy, like the acute myeloid leukemia. So, let's come to the etiology proper. We have a myelodysplastic syndrome. It can be due to lead poisoning, alcohol, mitochondrial disorders, as well as vitamin B6 deficiency. Some drugs can even lead to sideroblastic anemia, like isoniazid and all that. Okay, so myelodysplastic syndrome, lead poisoning, alcohol, mitochondrial disorders, vitamin B6 deficiency. Now, coming to the bone marrow smear, we can see the ringed sideroblast with cytoplasmic iron, which stains positive with Crucian bodies. Okay, and when we do an iron study, what we can see is an increased serum iron with decreased total iron binding capacity. Okay, there's a little information which I'm giving regarding the sideroblastic anemia, which is important. Okay. Now, one more thing I want to say, that the sideroblasts are abnormal nucleated erythroblasts with granules of iron accumulated in the mitochondria surrounding the nucleus. Okay, so this was about the sideroblast. So sideroblast is nothing but a genetic disorder, or it is caused due to a genetic disorder or a myelodysplastic syndrome. And these evolve into the hematological malignancy, like especially the acute myeloid leukemia. Okay, so next one is the hemolytic anemias. Now, coming to the hemolytic anemias, we need to know a little about the what is common to all the hemolytic anemias. So I've jotted down a few. There is jaundice and pallor. We have splenomegaly. We have hereditary hyperplasia, that is basically expansion of the marrow space and the bossing of the skull. Then hyperkalemia, that is increased potassium levels, increased serum LDH, then increased unconjugated bilirubin, increased urobilinogen in urine, increased reticulocytes, decreased or absent haptoglobin, then serum iron levels are high, decreased total iron binding capacity, and increased iron stores. Plus, we have hemosiderinuria as well as hemoglobinuria. That is, these two are especially in the intravascular hemolysis. Okay. Now, so these were the ones which are common to all the hemolytic anemias. The next one is the first one among the hemolytic anemia, is the autoimmune hemolytic anemia. Now, talking about the autoimmune hemolytic anemia, they classified on the basis of the character of the autoantibodies. Okay, so first one is the warm antibody type, and the next one is the cold antibody type. So first one, let's deal with the cold antibody type, in which the antibody that reacts with the polysaccharide antigens are usually the IgM. IgM. Okay, now let's talk about the etiological factors. A cold agglutinin disease, mycoplasma infection, infectious mononucleosis, paroxysmal cold hemoglobinuria. Okay, now this is one exception. The paroxysmal cold hemoglobinuria, in which it is IgG which is going to react. Okay, on all the others, they are IgM. Then cytomegalovirus as well as the lymphoma. I hope this is clear. Except for the paroxysmal cold hemoglobinuria, all the others are that one react with IgM. Paroxysmal cold hemoglobinuria, it reacts with IgG. Okay, now let's talk about the mechanism in which the RBC, when it reacts with the IgM, there's an agglutination taking place, which will lead to fixation of P3 to RBC surface. And that is the reason there is going to be a intravascular hemolysis. Okay, now coming to one more information, I would say that this cold antibody type, they react at a temperature which is 37 degrees Celsius. Okay, now, coming to warm antibody type, the autoantibody, this body actually, body, that is IgG, attacks the RBCs. Okay, etiological factors, the immune system neoplasms. Okay, immune system neoplasms like the chronic lymphoid leukemia, non-Hodgkin's lymphoma, then Huntington's disease, SLE. And apart from that, we have HIV. Okay, now next one is the mechanism in which the RBC, when with along with the IgG, it attacks the spleen and causes the extravascular hemolysis. Okay, now clinical features and lab diagnosis of both of this together. There is going to be jaundice and mild anemia, extravascular hemolytic anemia. The direct Coombs test will be positive. Then spherocytes and increased osmotic fragility. Okay, now basically the clinical features of the autoimmune hemolytic anemia is a little similar to that of the hereditary spherocytosis. Now, for differentiating, what we have to do is we have to do a Coombs test. Coombs test will be positive in autoimmune hemolytic anemia. It will be negative in case of a hereditary spherocytosis. I hope you have understood the autoimmune hemolytic anemia. Now, next, let's come to the hereditary spherocytosis. Okay, now talking about the hereditary spherocytosis, this is a disorder which is caused by the mutations in the genes relating to the membrane protein that allow for the erythrocytes to change the shape. So this is basically an autosomal dominant. Okay, inherited as autosomal dominant. So this is the most common protein defects, that is a membrane defects in hereditary spherocytosis. They are ankyrin and spectrin. So these are the two proteins which are defective, the most commonest one. Okay. Ankyrin is the most common mutation and it is the most common membrane defect, ankyrin. Okay, now talking about the spectrin, this is the most commonly relates with the severity of the disease. Ankyrin, it is the most common mutation and it is the most common membrane defect, whereas spectrin, it is the most commonly relates to the severity of the disease. Now, next one, coming to the clinical feature, we have massive splenomegaly with anemia, jaundice, and gallstones. Okay, massive splenomegaly with anemia, jaundice, and gallstones. This is the clinical feature. Coming to the lab diagnosis, there will be decreased MCV, increased MCFC, then increased osmotic fragility, and in the peripheral smear, we are going to see spherocytes. Spherocytes. Okay. So again, similar to that of the autoimmune hemolytic anemia, you have to do a Coombs test for this. Okay. So this was about hereditary spherocytosis. So what are the protein defects? That is ankyrin and the sphexin, important one. Okay. Next one is the paroxysmal nocturnal hemoglobinuria. Okay, paroxysmal nocturnal hemoglobinuria. Now, this is an acquired intracorpuscular anemia or intracorpuscular hemolytic anemia, I've taken over here. Now, this is characterized by a triad of complement-induced intravascular hemolytic anemia. Then we have a pancytopenia as well as thrombosis. Okay. Now, once again, I'll tell you, paroxysmal nocturnal hemoglobinuria is an acquired intracorpuscular hemolytic anemia, which is characterized by the triad of complement-induced intravascular hemolytic anemia, pancytopenia, and thrombosis. Now, coming to the a little of the clinical features. In this, what happens is the esophageal spasm, erectile dysfunction, and abdominal pain. Plus, there can be venous thrombosis. Now, why there is supposed to be, you know, esophageal spasms, erectile dysfunction, and all that? A little about the etiopathology, which you need to remember. So basically, there is a mutation in, I'll write over here better. So basically, there is a mutation in the PIGA gene. PIGA gene. Okay. Now, in this is basically anchored in the GPI protein. Okay. Now, one cause. Other one, there is a RBC membrane deficient in the DAF and MIRL, that is CD55 and CD59. And this one becomes susceptible to the complement-mediated lysis. And this one leads to activation of the complements. So basically, RBC membrane deficiency will occur. Okay. Now, because of this, there is an activation of the complements. And due to activation of the complements, there will be a red cell lysis. And due to this, there will be a nocturnal hemoglobinuria. Okay. Because of this, there will be nocturnal hemoglobinuria. Okay, so coming to the lab diagnosis, there is going to be pancytopenia, a complement-mediated thrombocytopenia also. Then we're going to see the gold standard for diagnosing. That's the flow cytometry of the granulocytes and the erythrocytes to evaluate for the presence of the glycosyl phosphatidyl linocytol. Okay, that is the linked antigens. Okay, so this is about a paroxysmal nocturnal hemoglobinuria. So hemolytic anemia is over. Next one, coming to the macrocytic anemias. Now, macrocytic anemia, we need to see the cause of vitamin B12 deficiency and the folic acid deficiency causes. So in the nutritional deficiency, basically it is in vegetarians. That is, in vegetarians, it's going to be vitamin B12 deficiency and the folic acid deficiency together. In malabsorption, there are conditions like pernicious anemia. Then we have gastric bypass surgery, then alcohol, as well as some kind of bariatric and metabolic surgeries also can lead to malabsorption and can lead to a vitamin B12 deficiency. Coming to the gastric causes, it can be total or a partial gastrectomy. Intestinal causes, we have intestinal stagnant loop syndrome, anatomic blind loop, iliac resection, Crohn's disease, tropical sphere, as well as a fish tapeworm. That is fish tapeworm we had already dealt with. That is Diphyllobotrium letter. Next one, some drugs like nitric oxide inhalation and primidone, pentamidine. Okay. So short bowel syndrome. Then we have iliac dissection or atresia, fish tapeworm. I have already told you this. Okay. So few other causes can be even liver diseases or even hypothyroidism or orotic aciduria. So these can be the other causes. So next one is about the folic acid deficiency. The causes are tropical spewing, malnutrition and malabsorption, anticonvulsant therapy, short bowel syndrome, some anti-cancer drugs, as well as a goat's milk consumption. So these are the few causes of vitamin B12 deficiency and the causes of folic acid deficiencies. Okay, so next one is other anemias. Like first one we are going to deal with is the sickle cell anemia. So sickle cell anemia is a group of genetic disorders, or sickle cell disease. It is a group of genetic disorders typically inherited in the autosomal resistant recessive pattern. So sickle cell anemia is the most commonest type is known as a sickle cell anemia. Okay, most commonest one is known as a sickle cell anemia in the sickle cell disease, which is characterized by hemolytic anemia with a sickling crisis. Now we'll see what a sickling crisis later on. Now what is the defect? The defect lies in the hemoglobin HbS. Okay, hemoglobin S. Okay, hemoglobin S is found in the RBCs, and this leads to a rigid sickle-like shape under circumstances. And what is the genetic defect? That is, a glutamate is substituted by valine at the sixth position in the beta chain of globin, which we already know. So sickle cell anemia, in which the glutamate is substituted by valine at sixth position in the beta chain of globin. Now, coming to a little of the clinical features, they are bone pain is the most commonest one. Then we have recurrent jaundice, polylithiasis, pulmonary arterial hypertension. Then we have CCF, we have renal papillary necrosis. Then hematuria, hand foot syndrome is again one important one. Then acute chest syndrome in adults. Okay. Now, the acute chest syndrome in adults is due to the mycoplasma. Now, coming to the lab diagnosis, we have normocytic normochromic anemia. We have autosplenectomy, decreased osmotic fragility, Howell-Jolly bodies, which I already mentioned at that point of time. And then target cells are present. Gamma-Gandy bodies are present. Leukocytosis, thrombocytosis, and hyperplastic marrow. So these are the lab diagnosis which you're going to see, or lab features. Normocytic normochromic anemia, autosplenectomy can be a history of autosplenectomy can be seen, and then decreased osmotic fragility, Howell-Jolly bodies, target cells are present, Gamma-Gandy bodies are present, leukocytosis, thrombocytosis, and hypoplastic marrow. Okay, now let's see what we were talking about, the sickle cell crisis. So sickle of sickling crisis, sickle cell crisis, otherwise termed to the sickling crisis. There are several independent acute conditions in this that the person is going to have, like vaso-occlusive crisis, aplastic crisis. Then we have secretion crisis, as well as we have a hemolytic crisis. Okay, so this is about the sickle cell crisis or sickling crisis. Then we saw the clinical feature, lab diagnosis, and what is the defect in case of a sickle cell anemia. Okay, next one we're going to deal with is a Fanconi's anemia. So Fanconi anemia, again, autosomal resistant inheritance. And in this, what will happen is aplastic anemia along with skeletal malformation. So in Fanconi anemia, you're going to see aplastic anemia along with that a skeletal malformation. Now, there is an abnormal chromosomal fragility in this. Basically, the cell fusion of Fanconi cells with normal cell produces a correction on the chromosomal fragility. Okay, that is what happens in this. Now, here we have a type A Fanconi anemia, which is the most commonest type. And that is due to a mutation in the FANCA, F-A-N-C-K, yes, F-A-N-C-A. Okay, in this gene. Now, next one, talking about the clinical features, there'll be hyperpigmentation of skin. There is short stature, then absent radii, hypoplastic or absent thymus, underdeveloped penis, undescended or absent or atrophic testis, then mental retardation. Okay. The lab diagnoses are pancytopenia leading to thrombocytopenia, then granulocytopenia, microcytopenia, hypocellular and fatty marrow. Okay, the complications of Fanconi's anemia are basically increased risk of the head or neck cancers. So basically what will happen? We have a type A Fanconi anemia, which is the most commonest one. And this is due to the mutation in the FANCA gene. Okay, FANCA gene. Okay, so this was about the Fanconi's anemia. Next one, we are going to deal with the disorders of bleeding and coagulation. Bleeding and coagulation. The first one we are going to deal with is the anaphylactoid purpura. The most commonest presentation is the palpable purpura, which is present in the or limited to the buttocks and the lower extremities. Next one, this is a self-limiting hypersensitivity or leukocytoclastic vasculitis, which involves the small and the medium-sized vessels. Okay, so anaphylactoid purpura. It's a self-limiting hypersensitivity or a leukocytoclastic vasculitis, which involves the small and the medium-sized vessels. And this is again the most commonest form of vasculitis in children. Okay, now coming to the clinical features, there is abdominal pain, malina, arthralgia, that is a non-migratory one, basically in the knee or the ankle. Then we have palpable purpura, or a pruritic rashes, basically centrifugal rashes. Then we have nephritis. Basically, the renal involvement is around 40% in the patient. The nephritis is important in that, or the commonest one in that. Coming to the lab diagnosis, the most commonest one is the or normal platelet count. And all the coagulation tests will be normal in this, and circulating immune complex deposited in the cell walls. And plus, there will be a mild leukocytosis as well as the IgA will be elevated in this case. So this is about the anaphylactoid purpura. So next one is the disseminated intravascular coagulation, or DIC. Now in this, the fibrinogen level correlates with the severity of the disease or the bleeding. Important. Now, the causes are Rocky Mountain spotted fever, then malaria or histoplasma, aspergillosis, acute promyelocytic leukemia, okay, then liver disease, heat stroke, polycythemia vera. And there are few obstacle causes like IUD, amniotic fluid embolism, retained placenta, and abruptio placenta. And the most commonest symptom in DIC is bleeding. Very important one. So fibrinogen level correlates with the severity of the disease and the bleeding in this. And causes are Rocky Mountain spotted fever or malaria, histoplasma, aspergillosis, acute promyelocytic leukemia, liver disease or heat stroke, and polycythemia vera. And few of the obstacle causes like IUD, amniotic fluid embolism, retained placenta, and abruptio placenta. Now coming to the laboratory features, we have thrombocytopenia, that is increase in the bleeding time, and as well as microangiopathic hemolytic anemia. Okay, so sites of thrombosis in DIC, basically they are brain, heart, lung, and kidney. This is important. This is a sequence. The first one should be the heart. Then, I'm sorry, first one should be the brain. Then the heart, then lung, and then the kidney. Okay? This is important. And one more thing which you need to remember, that in case of acute DIC, bleeding complications are more common. Okay? In chronic, that is basically the cancer-induced, thrombotic complications are more. Okay? So next one is about the platelet disorders. Now talking about the platelet disorders, first one is the immune thrombocytopenic purpura, or otherwise ITP. Okay, a little of the features. Age group is between the chronic and acute, acute and the chronic one. Age group is 2 to 6 years in case of acute. Onset is again acute one, as name goes. Preceding illness or association are viral infections or the upper respiratory infections. Then, spleen size is normal. Spontaneous remission is common in this case. And complications are rare in case of an acute immune thrombocytic purpura. Now, the most important is the chronic thrombocytic purpura. Any age, people can get affected with it. Insidious onset it has. And the preceding illness or associated diseases are SLE, then RA, then AIDS, as well as autoimmune hidradenitis. Spleen size may be normal in this case. Spontaneous remission is unusual. And complications are intracranial bleeding. Okay, intracranial bleeding. Now, a little of the treatment for acute immune thrombocytic purpura, basically they give steroids and then try to treat with it. But in case of a chronic one, they directly go in for a splenectomy. Now, let's see a little of the features. We have petechia purpura. Mucosal bleeding, spleen is usually not palpable. Okay. Now, coming to a little of the laboratory features. In case of a peripheral blood smear, we have decrease in the number of platelets with relatively large form seen. And bone marrow, we have increased number of megakaryocytes and abnormally long bleeding time. So, this is something which you need to remember in case of an immune thrombocytopenic purpura. Okay. Next one is the thrombotic thrombocytopenic purpura. Thrombotic thrombocytopenic purpura. This is basically caused due to the deficiency in the von Willebrand factor, metalloprotease. Okay. Deficiency of von Willebrand factor. Metalloprotease, and this causes thrombotic thrombocytopenic purpura. And the features are basically thrombocytopenia, hidden microthrombi throughout the body, as well as purpura. Okay, so that is why the term TTP, thrombotic thrombocytopenic purpura. Now there is a basic pentad of this. Okay. It's a fever, thrombocytopenia, microangiopathic hemolytic anemia, neurological deficit, as well as renal failure. This is a pentad of thrombotic thrombocytopenic purpura. And this is a rapid onset disease, and it can lead to a fatal condition. Now, death is usually due to an intracerebral hemorrhage. Now, let's see with the laboratory features. In this, the Coombs test will be negative. There is a negative hemolytic with cystocyte. And there is going to be a leukocytosis. And bone marrow, you're going to see a megakaryocytes, which are normal or increased in nature. Okay? So Coombs test is going to be negative. But there is going to be a cystocyte, which are going to be present. Plus, there is going to be leukocytosis. Pentad is something which you need to remember in this. It's a fever, thrombocytopenia, microangiopathic hemolytic anemia, neurological deficit, and the renal failure. Okay, this is something important. Now, coming to a thrombocytopenia, a little a differentiation between the immunological one and the non-immunological one. Immunological, we have a Coombs test which is positive. Non-immunological, Coombs test negative. Let's see the causes. In Coombs test positive or the immunological one, we have idiopathic thrombocytopenia purpura, discoid lupus erythematosus, that is DLE, as well as we have SLE. The causes of non-immunologic, that is the Coombs test which is negative, are that is disseminated intravascular coagulation, thrombotic thrombocytopenic purpura, as well as hemolytic uremic syndrome. Okay, so this was about the thrombocytopenia. Now let's talk about the platelet defects a little one. Let's see the abnormality and where it is seen in. Aggregation of the platelets. I repeat, aggregation of the platelets are seen in Glanzmann's thrombobastinia. Okay, thrombastinia, no, there is no thrombo, thrombastinia. Addition of the platelets are seen in von Willebrand factor. That is secretion basically of alpha granules are seen in the great platelet syndrome, and the secretion of dense granules are seen in Chedak-Higashi syndrome, Viskovs-Aldrich syndrome, and the TAR syndrome. So this is important. Aggregation is seen in Glanzmann thrombastinia, addition in the von Willebrand factor, then alpha granule secretion in the gray platelet syndrome, and dense granule secretions in the Chedak-Higashi syndrome, Viskovs-Aldrich syndrome, as well as TAR syndrome. Okay, so this was about a little information, additional information regarding the thrombocytopenia as well as a platelet defect. Next one, let's go into the coagulation disorders. I know this is a little vast, but we are trying to finish it off so that it remains in your mind. So coagulation disorders, we'll deal with the hemophilia A, hemophilia B, the Christmas disease, hemophilia C, the parahemophilia or the Orange disease, as well as the von Willebrand factor, otherwise called to be a pseudohemophilia. Okay, now the deficient factor is 8, hemophilia A. The bleeding time is going to be normal and the clotting time is going to be very much increased. Hemophilia B, that is a Christmas disease in which the factor deficiency is 9. Bleeding time is normal and clotting time is increased. Hemophilia C, the clotting, the factor deficient is factor 11. Bleeding time will be normal and clotting time is increased. Parahemophilia or the Orange disease, factor deficient is going to be factor 5. And Willebrand factor or the pseudohemophilia, the factor deficient is the Willebrand factor as such, as well as the 8. Or factor 8. Bleeding time is going to be increased and the clotting time is also going to be increased in this case. Important ones I have noted down. Hemophilia A, B, C, parahemophilia, as well as the pseudohemophilia, otherwise termed to be a von Willebrand factor disease. Now let's come to the hemophilia A. The hemophilia A, basically it is caused by the deficiency of the AHF, that is a factor 8. Okay, now basically there is going to be a spontaneous bleeding. Not common, but when active, the bleeding starts. The spontaneous bleeding is not common actually, but when the active bleeding starts, the hemostasis is not at all achieved. Next one, the patients are always male, as it is transmitted as a X-linked recessive trait. Patients are always male, as it is transmitted as a X-linked recessive trait. Coming to the lab diagnosis, the platelet counts are normal or raised in case of a hemophilia A. Now, with regards to this, we'll talk about the hemophilia B. Hemophilia B is otherwise termed to be Christmas disease, which I've already mentioned. Okay, and factor 9 is going to be affected. That's the only information. And again, it's a X-linked recessive disorder. Now, coming to the von Willebrand disease. It is characterized by decreased or defective von Willebrand factor, which is associated with secondary disease in the factor VIII. I repeat, there is going to be decreased or defective Von Willebrand factor, which is associated with secondary decrease in the factor VIII. Okay, and this is most common method or most common mode of inheritance, that is autosomal dominant. The clinical features are skin and mucosal bleeding. The lab diagnosis are decreased factor VIII and VIIIC. Then there is going to be defect in the platelet and prolonged bleeding time. Okay. See, I'm not dealing in detail with everything. Just telling you the important points which are very important for you to remember for the exam point of view. The next one, dealing with the myeloproliferative disorders. So talking about the myeloproliferative disorder, the first one is the polycythemia vera. We'll just note down which are the important ones. In polycythemia vera, we have a decreased ESR and we have a decreased erythropoietin. Plus, there is going to be normal arterial SpO2 and rest all are increased. Then, decreased TLC, that is leukocytosis. Total leukocyte count is increased. Basically, there is going to be a leukocytosis. Increased red cell mass and hemocrit, which leads to increased viscosity and again, which in turn leads to the increased systolic BP. Then increased platelets, increased spleen. Then we have increased turnover of HCT also. Okay, so increased risk of both bleeding and thrombosis. Histamine release is there, which leads to itching. Neurological symptoms like headache, vertigo, tinnitus, all these depression is going to have. Get plus bleeding from the GIT and epistasis, a very important one for polycythemia vera. Okay, now next one, deal with the essential thrombocytosis. Now, in this, basically, this is a myeloproliferative disease which is characterized by increase in the platelet count without any recognizable stimulus. So basically, platelet aggregation within microcirculation, results in arterial venous thrombosis and easy bruising. The lab diagnosis, they are platelet count. Then there is more than 4 lakh per microliter. Okay. Then we have large platelets or hyperdiploid cells. Then we have megakaryocytes, cytic or fragment which are present, and hypergranular platelets. Then mild or increased total leukocyte count and normal HB count. Okay, so splenomegaly is not seen in this. In this, there is an increase, enlarged spleen. But in this, at polycythemia vera, we have enlarged spleen, but essential thrombocytosis, we do not have a splenomegaly. Next one, talk about the leukemias. In the leukemia, the most important one we are going to deal a little informations are commonest leukemia age-wise. That is in children, that is less than 15 years, that is acute lymphoid leukemia. 15 to 40 years, that is acute myeloid leukemia. 40 to 60 year age group, both we have acute myeloid leukemia as well as chronic myeloid leukemia. And in elderly, more than 60 years, we have a chronic lymphoid leukemia. That is age-wise. Okay, so acute lymphoid leukemia is the most common leukemia in children and overall most common malignancy of children. All information, that is, chronic lymphoid leukemia is the most common leukemia overall and it has the most insidious onset also. And A leukemia is seen in acute myeloid leukemia and acute lymphoid leukemia. Okay. Now coming to the topic proper, we have an acute lymphoid leukemia. Now in acute lymphoid leukemia, let's see a little of the prognostic factors for acute lymphoid leukemia. Now let's see the determinants. That is age in years as well as
the gender. So favorable, that is 2 to 8 years, and females are usually affected. Unfavorable ones are, it's less than 1 and in between 1 and 10. Okay, now, males are unfavorable. And then the total leukocyte count, less than 20,000, unfavorable is more than 1 lakh. And cytogenetics, that is hyperdiploidy, hyperploidy, and trisomy. Unfavorable ones are hypodiploidy and the pH chromosome. Translocation, that is the TEL or AML1 genes rearrangement. An unfavorable one is 9:22 and 4:11. Immunophenotype, favorable one is the early pre B cell, and unfavorable ones are presence of T cell and the mature B cells. Okay, now in this acute lymphoid leukemia, there is going to be the metaphyseal translucences. Okay, that is the earliest and the most characteristic features of childhood leukemia. So metaphyseal translucences, that is earliest and the most characteristic feature of childhood leukemia. And there is going to be a leukemia cutis. Now basically that is the infiltration of the neoplastic leukocytes or their precursors into the epidermis, dermis, or the subcutis, resulting in the clinical identifiable cutaneous lesions. Okay, now basically, in case of immunohistochemistry, it will show strongly positive myeloperoxidase infiltrating cells. Okay, in case of acute lymphoid leukemia. Next one, is acute myeloid leukemia. Now basically, acute myeloid leukemia is always associated with Down syndrome or Petau syndrome or Klinefelter syndrome, as well as ataxia, telangiectasia, then Fanconi's anemia, as well as sideroblastic anemia. So I repeat, this is usually associated with Down syndrome, Petau syndrome, Klinefelter's syndrome, ataxia, telangiectasia, then Fanconi's anemia, sideroblastic anemia. Now, basically, all roads are seen in acute myeloid lymphoma, leukemia, arising from myeloblast. Okay, so leukemia developing in myelodysplastic syndrome is the AML. When there is normal cytogenetics, deletion of X or Y chromosome, translocations and mutated nucleophosmin, we have a favorable prognosis of acute myeloid leukemia. Okay, and AML is associated with specific mutations in the genes such as FLT3, nucleophosmin, and KIT, or you can say KIT. So this is a little information. There are, you know, in case of AML, there are a lot many types, right, from M0 to M7. Okay. The acute myeloid leukemia with maturation, that is the most commonest type, that will come under the M2 type. M2. Okay. Acute promyelocytic leukemia, or otherwise we can call it to be APL, that will come under the M3. Okay. The next one is a chronic lymphoid leukemia. Now, talking about the chronic lymphoid leukemia, that is present in typical B cell. Okay. In case of typical B cell chronic lymphoid leukemia, trisomy 12 conveys a poorer prognosis. And cytogenetics, if you're talking about deletion of 13q14 or deletion of 11th chromosome. Okay, that happens in case of a chronic lymphoid leukemia. That's not much important for our point of view. Then, proliferation centers in lymphatics is pathognomic in chronic lymphoid leukemia. And we have something called Richter syndrome, which is important. The chronic lymphoid leukemia transformation into diffuse large B-cell lymphoma. That time we call it to be a Richter syndrome. Okay, Richter syndrome. That is serial transformation into diffuse large B-cell lymphoma. Okay, so this is the only information which you need to know. Now coming to the chronic myeloid leukemia, This is otherwise termed to be a disease of first. It is the first disease for which the word leukemia was used. That is chronic myeloid leukemia. Okay? No, so in this, it is associated with massive splenomegaly. This is the only leukemia with thrombocytosis. Okay, leading to CML, in which there is going to be increased platelet, increased neutrophils, and increased basophils. In CML, sometimes the symptom is dragging sensation to the abdomen due to extreme splenomegaly. So we have mentioned we have massive splenomegaly, and due to the splenomegaly, there is going to be a dragging sensation in the abdomen. Then persistent splenomegaly despite continued therapy is a sign of disease acceleration. Okay, now plus there is going to be lymphadenopathy which is present, and if it is present, there is going to be poor prognosis. Apart from that, the serum levels of vitamin B12 and vitamin B12 binding capacity is increased. When we do a blood smear, remember this vitamin B12 and the vitamin B12 capacity is increased. It's a very important point. Okay, so coming to the blood smear, it reveals extramedullary hematopoiesis that causes hepatosplenomegaly. Then there is presence of teardrop cells, then nucleated red cells, myelocytes, and promyelocytes. Then in bone marrow aspiration shows hypercellularity. Then there is going to be increased LDH and increased ALP, alkaline phosphatase. Okay. Then splenic infarcts also can be present. Now, risk of developing acute leukemias have actually an aggressive course. So this was about the chronic myeloid leukemia, a very important among all these. Known as the disease of first. Disease of first. Massive splenomegaly will be there. If lymphadenopathy is there, poor prognosis. Serum levels of vitamin B12 and vitamin B12 binding capacity is increased. Blood smear will reveal extramedullary hematopoiesis, teardrop cells, nucleated red cells, myelocytes, and promyelocytes. These are the important points. Next one, let's come to a smaller one, that is a hairy cell leukemia. This is a B cell neoplasm due to Epstein-Barr virus. Then there is going to be monocytopenia, massive splenomegaly, and vasculitis in case of hairy cell leukemia. The cause of death is usually Legionella pneumonia. Then in bone marrow, what we can see is a pattern of fibrosis with infiltration of malignant cells. And there is going to be a large aggregate of CD20 and lymphocytes. So this was about hairy cell leukemia. Remember, it's a B cell neoplasm due to Epstein-Barr virus. Cause of death is Legionella pneumonia. Okay. The next one, I'm going to be dealing with the lymphomas. So in the lymphomas, the first one is the mycosis fungoids, which is otherwise termed to be the cutaneous T lymphoma, T cell lymphoma, cutaneous T cell lymphoma. And remember that it begins in the skin and may remain confined to the skin for a long time. It begins in skin and may remain confined to skin for a longer time. It involves CD4 plus T helper cells. And again, it involves the skin, it involves the lymph node and other organs. Now, when the neoplastic cells, these enter the peripheral bloodstream, these are known as the Tesari syndrome. And when it's in the skin itself, it is known as, it is shown as a Portria microabscessus. Okay? So Portria microabscessus are seen in case of a mycosis fungoids, otherwise termed to be a cutaneous T-cell lymphoma. If the neoplastic cells are seen in the peripheral bloodstream, we call it to be a Tesari syndrome, important one. Okay. So the next one is the Hodgkin's disease. Now, Hodgkin's disease, basically what you need to remember is the neoplastic T or B lymphocyte cell origin basically the Hodgkin's disease is a neoplastic T or B lymphocyte cell origin, and they have a characteristic owl eye appearance. And what is the hallmark of Hodgkin's disease? That is the Reed-Sternberg cells. Reed-Sternberg cells, or the RS cells, they are the hallmark of Hodgkin's disease. Okay, so there's the most commonest type of Hodgkin's disease is the nodular sclerosing type. And most commonest type of Hodgkin's disease in females is the nodular sclerosing type. Other types are more common in males. Okay, so talking about other ones, I'll tell you. Basically, there are going to be lymphocyte predominance. There is going to be nodular sclerosis, which is in females. Then mixed cellularity. Then it's going to be a lymphocytic depletion type. So these are the types. Except for the nodular sclerosis, others are common in the males. Nodular sclerosis is common in the females. The most common presentation of childhood Hodgkin's lymphoma, that is cervical lymphadenopathy. Cervical lymphadenopathy. So coming to the lymphocyte predominance type, the cell type is going to be a popcorn cell or LNH cells. Popcorn cells are basically a polyploidal cells. And the prognosis is excellent in this case. In case of nodular sclerosis, the cell type which you're going to see is lacunar cells. And it has a good prognosis. Mixed cellularity, which is having a mononuclear type Reed-Sternberg cells. And the prognosis intermediate one. And lastly, we have a lymphocytic depletion type, in which the cell is basically a sarcomatous or pleomorphic Reed-Sternberg cells. And this is having the worst prognosis. Lymphocytic depletion type is having the worst prognosis. And mediastinal involvement is the most commonest one in nodular sclerosing type. Okay, so this is about Hodgkin's disease. Coming to the non-Hodgkin one. So non-Hodgkin's disease, basically there is a classification the classification, we call it to be a Rappaport's classification. Anyhow, we'll deal with it. So talking about small lymphocytic. So I'll tell in short, small lymphocytic non-Hodgkin's lymphoma or follicular non-Hodgkin's lymphoma, mantle cell non-Hodgkin's lymphoma, and the diffuse large B cell non-Hodgkin's lymphoma, these are having a B cell, as well as the Burkitt's lymphoma. These are having the B cell. Whereas lymphoblastic non-Hodgkin's lymphoma, they are having an immature T cell. I repeat, small lymphocytic, follicular, mantle cell, diffuse large B cell, and the Burkitt's lymphoma, they are having a B cell type. Lymphoblastic non-Hodgkin's lymphoma are going to be having an immature T cell. So let's see the clinical feature is present in whom. So small lymphocytic is present in the adults. Follicular is present in adults again. And here we have an overexpression of the BCCI2. Then mantle cell again in adults. Diffuse large B cells in the adults. That is 80% in the brain in the HIV patient. This is important. Diffuse large B cell. The clinical features are present in the adults and having 80% in the brain in HIV patient. Talking about the lymphoblastic, there is a T cell. It is present in the children. And Burkitt's lymphoma, again B cell. The clinical feature, the most commonest one, that most common non-Hodgkin's lymphoma in children and associated with Epstein-Barr virus and jaw lesions. So this is important. Okay, now one more thing which is important is the small lymphocytic non-Hodgkin's lymphoma, they resemble the chronic lymphoid leukemia and the lymphoblastic one. The lymphoblastic, they resemble the acute lymphoid leukemia. So small lymphocytic, they resemble the chronic lymphoid leukemia. Lymphoblastic, they resemble the acute lymphoid leukemia. Okay, so the most common extranodal site of primary malignant non-Hodgkin's lymphoma is the stomach. So this is something very important one. And the prognosis, nodular have more favorable than the diffused one. And lymphocytic have more favorable than histiocytic.
That is a cell type.
Okay, so this was about the non-Hodgkin's lymphoma. Next, go to the Burkitt's lymphoma. Now, in case of Burkitt's lymphoma, basically it is a B-cell lymphoma. And it was initially seen in African adolescent, an African adolescent boy, as a jaw tumor. And this one can spread to extranodal sites such as bone marrow and even the CNS. That is, in CNS, basically the meninges may be involved. And even the peripheral lymphadenopathy, or even there can be an intra-abdominal mass that can be seen. Okay, apart from that, there can be high-grade, small, non-cleaved lymphocytic leukemia. It has a high mitotic or a proliferating activity. This is Burkitt's lymphoma is one of the fastest-growing neoplasm. And the most common site of Burkitt's lymphoma is in the abdominal cavity, wherein what you can see that the pale patches of the small intestine in the boys and the pelvic cavity in the girls. That is the most common site. Pale patches of the small intestine in case of boys and pelvic cavity in case of girls. And Burkitt's lymphoma, they're associated with Epstein-Barr virus. And on microscopy, there is going to be a starry sky pattern. Starry sky pattern. Okay. And in which macrophage forms stars. Okay. Macrophage forms the stars. So this was about the Burkitt's lymphoma. Now, coming to the, I think the second last one among the lymphomas, that is the Langer cells, Langer cell histiocytes. Now, in this condition, there are three diseases which I include. One is the eosinophilic granuloma, Hand-Schüssler-Christian disease, and Lettre-Swy disease. The most common site of eosinophilic granuloma is the skull. There is going to be unifocal or lytic bone lesion. This is the most commonest form. Eosinophilic granuloma is the most commonest form, which is characterized by a geographical skull. That is a punched out lucences in the skull vault. And then there is going to be in the vertebra, there is going to be a single vertebra plana. And there is going to be a problem in the pelvis as well as the femur. Okay. Next one, in case of a Hand-Schüssler-Christian disease. Hand-Schüssler-Christian disease, the most common site is the skull. And it is again having a multifocal or lytic bone lesion. And the characteristic features are triad of exophthalmos, DI, and lytic lesions in the skull. Okay, and plus. Next one is a Lettre-Swy disease. This is going to be most common site is the diffused one everywhere. Multifocal and cystic bone lesion is going to happen. And this is an aggressive disease. Lettre-Swy disease is an aggressive one, which is characterized by diffuse eczematous rashes, splenomegaly, and pancytopenia. Okay, so this is about the Langerhans cell histiocytosis. So once again, eosinophilic granuloma, they're having punched out lucences in the skull vault, and then single vertebra plana, and yeah, so this is about eosinophilic granuloma. In case of a Hand-Schüssler-Christian disease, we're going to have a triad of exophthalmos, diabetes insipidus, and lytic lesions of the skull. And then in case of a Lettre-Swy disease, the aggressive one, in which we are going to have diffuse eczematous rashes, splenomegaly, and pancytopenia. Then coming to the all of the other information, there is all these histiocytes, there is all the three of these cells are CD1A positive. Okay, and Langerhans cells are HLA-DR positive. Means and, okay. So all histiocytosis cells are CD1A positive and Langerhans cells are HLA-DR positive. Plus, characteristic of all the histiocytosis are Langerhans granules, basically there are some granules, that is Langerhans granules. They have a tennis racket appearance. Or even they can be, otherwise we have a Burbix granules. Then histiocytes which are present, they're the modified macrophages. They usually have a coffee bean nuclei in it. Okay, so this was about the Langerhans cells, histiocytosis. So next one is the multiple myeloma. I think the last one among the lymphomas. Coming to the multiple myeloma, it's otherwise termed to be a plasma cell myeloma. And there is a classical triad, that is a marrow plasma cytosis, lytic bone lesion, and the serum or urine M complement. So next one, information that is alkaline phosphatase level is normal in this, but there is going to be increased ESR. There is going to be hypergammaglobulinemia, hypercalcemia, and increased urea or creatinine ratio and uric acid. The diagnostic criteria in case of a multiple myeloma is M protein in serum or urine. Bone marrow plasma cells are plasma cells or plasma cytoma. Then myeloma related organ or tissue impairment. The most common sites of lytic bone lesions are first one vertebra, next rib, next skull, next is pelvis, and lastly is a femur. Then bone pain is the most common symptom, which involves the back, that is the spine, ribs, and the sternum. In case of lab diagnosis, we are going to see anemia, which is normocytic normochromic type, then hyperuricemia, as well as increased ESR. Then it is associated with hypercalcemia, which leads to metastatic calcification in the kidney, where it's a very important feature of multiple myeloma. It's associated with hypercalcemia. Okay. Now, one more thing which you need to remember is that there is going to be serum beta macroglobulin. And this is the most important single powerful predictor for prognosis of multiple myeloma. Now, with regards to all this, now we need to know a little of the pathological feature. There is going to be, you know, cells, a few cells which you need to remember. This may be asked in the exams, like flame cell. There is going to be flame cell. That is, flame cell means the cells with fiery red cytoplasm. There is going to be mott cells. There is multiple grape-like droplets. Then crystalline rods and Dutcher bodies, Russell bodies and plasma cells. So these are the pathological, you know, features which are going to be definite in case of a multiple myeloma. Okay, so diagnostic criteria, which is very important, you need to remember in this. Now, bone pain, which is very most common symptom, then it is associated with hypercalcemia and serum beta macroglobulin. So this is something which you needed to know about multiple myeloma. Now, coming to a little about the shelf life of blood products as well as the blood groupings. So blood product. So we have fresh frozen plasma. Shelf life is 1 hour in the frozen condition. Okay. Frozen condition, 1 hour. And if it's refrigerated, it's 24 hours. Then cryoprecipitate, that is 1 hour, again frozen, 4 to 6 hour at room temperature after it is thawed. Then cryoprecipitated, okay, first one we already dealt with, the cryoprecipitate. That was in 1 hour, that is frozen. We have 4 to 6 hours at room temperature after thawed. Next one is the cryoprecipitated anti-hemophilic factor. That is, shelf life is going to be 1 hour, which is frozen. Then whole blood, shelf life is 21 to 35 days when refrigerated. And if it is unrefrigerated, it's going to be 24 hours. RBCs, shelf life is 42 days. Washed RBCs, that is 24 hours. Frozen red cells, it is going to be 10 years at minus 80 degrees Celsius. And platelets, that is 5 days when closed and 24 hours opened at a room temperature. In many question papers, we have seen the shelf life is being asked. So very important one this is. Next one, talking about the clotting factors. Clotting factor, I'll just go through 1 to 13. One is fibrinogen. Second one is prothrombin. Third one, thromboplastin. 4, the calcium. 5, the proaxillin, the labile factor. 7, the proconvertin. A, the anti-hemophilic factor. Then 9, Crisis factor. 10, Stuart power factor. 11, plasma thromboplastin antecedent on the anti-hemophilic factor C. Then 12, the Hageman factor or the glass contact factor. 13 is the Lackey-Laurent factor. Okay, now in this, we have a factor 7. Factor 7 is exclusive to the extrinsic system and hence it is not consumed in the clotting factor. Okay, this is important one. Now, among the coagulation factor, the factor 12 deficiency. Factor 12 deficiency does not produce bleeding, but it produces thrombosis. All the other produces bleeding. But 12, the Hageman factor deficiency or the glass contact factor deficiency, they lead to thrombosis. Then cryoprecipitate contains factor 8 plus von Willebrand factor multimer and fibrinogen, fibrinectin and factor 13. That is a Lackey-Laurent factor. Okay, now next one, the fresh frozen plasma contains factor 8 and factor 9. Then we have adsorbed plasma that contains factor 5, 8, 11 and 12. And lastly, we have a normal serum contains factor 9, 10, 11 and 12. So this is a little important. You need to, you know, register into yourself. What and all makes a cryoprecipitate, what FFP contains what, adsorbed plasma contains factor 5, 8, 11, 12 and so is normal serum. What does it contain? It contains the factor 9, 10, 11 and 12. Next one, we are talking about the blood groups. So in case of blood group, remember the blood group antigens are usually or basically the mucopolysaccharides. And the ABO antigens are basically found on the red cells and most body fluids like saliva, semen, sweat or membranes of intestine, urothelium and vascular endothelium. Okay, it is found in the red cells as well as all the most of the body fluids. Next one, the commonest type of blood group is O positive. The first one is O positive, next is A positive, then B positive and we have a AB negative. This is the sequential order of the common type of blood groups. So something we talk about the ABO incompatibility. Now, just remember, the blood groups involved in the ABO incompatibility are O of the mother and AB or AB of the baby. So what is incompatibility? ABO incompatibility is the O of the mother, AB or AB of the baby. Now, coming to the Rh incompatibility. The blood group involved in Rh incompatibility is Rh negative mother, Rh positive father and Rh positive baby. Important one, remember. And this is the most commonest naturally occurring antibodies are anti-Lewis IgM antibody of no, they have no clinical significance, but they are naturally occurring antibodies. Okay. So antigens located in the platelets are ABO and HLA. Antigens located on the platelets are ABO and HLA. So this was about the blood grouping. One more, compatible blood groups for patients. An important one. Okay. So if the patient is O, having a blood group of O, whole blood should be O, pactyl O, and like everything should be O. Okay. Cryoprecipitate of fresh frozen plasma, everything, platelet, everything should be of O. But whereas a patient is having who is A, the whole blood or the packed cell, black red cell, it can be A or it can be O grouping. But frozen plasma, there should be A or AB. Platelet again, A more than AB. And cryoprecipitate should be A. Again, in the same way, like that of the A grouping, the B also is having. Whole blood should be B or O. Packed red cell should be B or O. The fresh frozen plasma should be B or AB. And platelet B and then AB. Then cryo should be A. But then for patient having AB, it should be whole blood cell, any blood group is okay. Packed red cell, any blood grouping is okay. Frozen fresh plasma or fresh frozen plasma, any blood grouping group is also okay. For platelet, it should be AB. and cryoprecipitate, it should be A. So this was about the compatible blood groups for patients. Thus, we have managed to finish a little of the hematology in one class. This is a huge topic. So to complete it in one class, this is a little difficult, but we have tried our best. You will understand it more when you listen to this class and then go back to your textbooks, you know, authentic textbooks, and read it once again. And that will be helpful for you to remembering to remember all the points for the exam. Thank you.